Hey guys, so I'm continuing to talk more about the field of psychology and the field of social work. And this is actually, this area about values and code of ethics, this area, the two fields have lots of commonalities. Both fields have their own published code of ethics. You know, for social work, there's the NASW, which is the National Association of Social Workers Code of Ethics. It's available free online. And same thing with psychology. Psychology has, let me look at the names. It is the Ethical Principles, Psychologists, and Code of Conduct by American Psychological Association. So, NASW Code of Ethics, APA Code of Ethics, very similar. So there's a lot of commonality between what we think about with psychologists and social workers. And probably at this point, we can probably include other fields as well, such as doctors, psychiatrists, counselors, mental health counselors, and such of that nature. There's a lot of commonality with ethical principles and codes of conduct and code of ethics, because the overall code of ethics that we are following, you know, demands these kind of things. So there are those. What I find particularly interesting is the kind of the focus each profession places on certain values. Psychology is kind of, it's very much like a medical field, you know. And medical field, you hear that term, you hear this phrase a lot, which is do no harm. And that's one of the very first things that the psychologist code of ethics mentioned from what I saw. It's also, you know, the idea of evidence-based practice is also really heavily in both professions, but I think in psychology is especially, there's heavier emphasis on evidence-based practice, on research. So, you know, the professional should have the most up-to-date research and should do their best to further research, further knowledge about human beings, how human beings operate, and how that knowledge can be used to help treat clients. I think while social work does have some focus on that, I think, you know, psychology places much more importance on that. I think where social work is kind of, you know, different in placing their emphasis. Now, just realize all these fields have these code of ethics. All the fields are concerned. Social workers are, of course, concerned with doing no harm. That, you know, it's not like there's a big difference there. The difference is only is in, like, the degree of emphasis, I think. And when you look at NASW Code of Ethics, you know, I think you'll notice that the first thing it talks about is not about research, is not about doing no harm, it's not about, like, competence. Well, it is about competence, actually, but it's not particularly about, like, for example, I'm going to take a look at the ethical principles of psychologists and code of conduct. The preamble says this: psychologists are committed to increasing scientific and professional knowledge of behavior and people's understanding of themselves and others, and to the use of such knowledge to improve condition of individuals, organizations, and society. Psychologists respect and protect civil and human rights and the central importance of freedom of inquiry and expression in research, teaching, and publication. They strive to help the public in developing informed judgments and choices concerning human behavior. In doing so, they perform many roles, such as researcher, educator, diagnostician, therapist, supervisor, consultant, administrator, social interventions, and expert witness. The ethics code provides a common set of principles and standards upon which psychologists build their profession and scientific work. The ethics code is intended to provide scientific standards to cover most situations uncovered by psychologists. It has as its goals the welfare and protection of individuals and groups with whom psychologists work, and the education of members, students, and the public regarding ethical standards of the discipline. So that's kind of the beginning part of the preamble of the ethical standard for psychologists. And that is how it begins. And this is how social work preamble is. So NASW Code of Conduct preamble kind of goes like this. It's a little bit different, but you'll notice a lot of the similar themes. It goes: the primary mission of the social work profession is to enhance human well-being and help meet the basic needs of all people, with particular attention to the needs and empowerment of people who are vulnerable, oppressed, and living in poverty. A historic and defining feature of social work is the profession's focus on individual well-being in a social context and the well-being of society. Fundamental to social work is attention to the environmental forces that create, contribute to, and address the problems in living. Social workers promote social justice and social change with and on behalf of clients. Clients is used inclusively to refer to individuals, families, groups, organizations, and communities. Social workers are sensitive to cultural and ethnic diversity and strive to end discrimination, oppression, poverty, and other forms of social injustice. These activities may be in the form of direct practice, community organizing, supervision, consultation, administration, advocacy, social and political action, policy development and implementation, education, and research evaluation. Social workers seek to enhance the capacity of people to address their own needs. Social workers also seek to promote the responsiveness of organizations, communities, and other social institutions to individuals' needs and social problems. That's the beginning part. I'm not going to read the whole preamble, but that's the beginning part of the NASW Code of Ethics. I'm pretty sure that you guys kind of get the different emphasis there. A lot of the word social is thrown out with social work, you know, especially the concept of social justice. And that's kind of where the Code of Ethics for social workers begins. The first concept of Code of Ethics in, you know, the first thing mentioned, I don't know if this detail by emphasis or importance or whatever, but, you know, one of the first things it mentioned is cultural competency and social diversity. So it's really, you know, about the concept of, like, not making sure to end discrimination, racial discrimination, sexual discrimination, and sexual orientation discrimination, immigration discrimination, all that. Social work is highly considerate of that, highly interested and concerned with that. It's also one of the, so you'll notice that, like, social work is more concerned with, like, the environmental factors of social injustice, where psychology is kind of more focused on, at least the Code of Ethics, talking about doing no harm to the individual and making sure that the person is respected, making sure that research is furthered as much as possible to improve the well-being of individuals and their psychology and their mental health and all that. So, I don't know. I mean, I know much more about social work as a social work student. So, I mentioned before in previous videos, that's where my bias is. But I do think social work Code of Ethics is particularly interesting on two fronts. So its emphasis on social justice, and this term, I think the problem with this term in our field of social work is that it's kind of thrown around lightly a lot of times. It's thrown around a lot, you know. I think some of my professors have been guilty of this, both in undergrad and currently in graduate school. It's just like, well, yeah, it's about social justice. That's like the answer to almost everything. It's like, it's about social justice. Like, okay, like, instead of throwing that word around, let's be more specific about what that kind of means. But, like, getting to that, it's a very touchy subject because it does kind of touch on the politics of the whole thing. But, you know, what is important is that the value is that no one should be prevented from receiving quality services simply because they're poor or simply because they're discriminated against. And that kind of is the more social justice aspect of it, which is why, like, I wonder, like, you know, this was actually joked about in one of my classes, like, you know, can there be Republican or conservative social workers? You know, and a lot of people laughed, and, like, the professor's response was the most interesting. And he said, well, you know, I understand that sentiment, but you do have to consider this. If there are no Republican social workers, then the profession is in trouble. Because, you know, you do need diversity of viewpoints. So, it's he was kind of pointing to the fact that, you know, we don't want this field to be so polarizing when you consider the fact that 50% of American population are Republican. You know, so by not allowing Republicans, well, I mean, I'm not saying social worker as a profession does not allow Republicans to be social workers. I'm pretty sure they're out there. But, like, with the emphasis we place on some things like social justice, it just makes me wonder, like, if there are... What I think is kind of impossible is not a Republican social worker. I think that's possible. I certainly think that's possible and it exists everywhere. But, like, what I think is, like, really, really, really unlikely, but still possible, really unlikely, are libertarian social workers. I can't even imagine. I don't know. Anyway, social justice is one of the key values. Also, the right to self-determination. This is a big thing in the social work field. It's not necessarily as a big... It's still an important value in the field of psychology. But I wonder, like, if it's... Because it's you know, we social workers believe in the dignity and worth of individuals. Psychology does as well. That's a shared value. But what that also means for social workers is that every person is the expert of themselves. You know, I know myself better than anyone else, and so does that one person. You know, that client might be engaging in very self-destructive behaviors. You know, drug addiction, sex work, you know, cutting oneself. You know, these behaviors that are very self-destructive. A client may be doing that. Or a client may be, you know, some of the clients that social workers do see are what society would consider as deviant and as criminal. There are social workers in prisons, and their clients are, guess what, criminals. So, some of the clients that social workers see are, you know, they committed rape, they committed murder. Social workers do see them, and we do work with such clients, and they are considered clients. But we do consider, like, everyone's individual work and dignity, even murderers, which is a concept that is hard to grasp for a lot of people. Is, you know, and this is why I think what makes Republican social workers so unlikely is that if you are a social worker, like, you automatically have to give up the idea of believing in the death penalty or capital punishment. Like I know not every Republican believes in death penalty, but like. And I think that's it's a Republican belief. I mean, that's not also saying that, you know, there are plenty of Democrats who do believe in death penalty. But it's just kind of, you know, that's a more conservative concept, you know? And I do have to wonder, like some things like that really make me wonder, like, Republican social worker. Good luck, anyway. But, you know, I welcome it. I welcome diversity of the field. But it is interesting, you know, we do work with those kind of clients. We work with rapists. And we work with murderers, and that's where, like, this idea of self-determination becomes really challenging. And that's why I think being a social worker, there's so many ethical dilemmas to work around. One example I give recently, where I intern at, it's a school, so it's a field of school social work. One of the students is a... Well, you know what, let me not give an actual example, but let me just make up a hypothetical situation. So, let's say there's a student, you know, who, is very, like, disinterested in school. Like, in school, he doesn't really display his emotions all that well. He's very dissociated, with, you know, disengaged at school. But in therapy, you know, he reveals that at home, he uses this stick, and he beats his mom up. You know, he does that when he gets angry at his mom. Just beats her up, you know? So clearly, you know, in this case, it's the opposite of child abuse, you know? It's the exact opposite. And so, this is a case where the value of the right to self-determination is kind of hard to value, right? Like, the client is being aggressive toward another person, is inflicting harm on a family member, on his mother. And the mother, you know, you meet with the mother, and the mother, you know, you have therapy with the mother, and the mother has symptoms of Stockholm Syndrome. You know, I mean, of course you would. It's your son. You know, even beyond just that. So, like... You know, at which point you do, there is a boundary, there's a line to be drawn with these kind of values. You know, we respect the right to confidentiality of a client, but there are exceptions to that. You know, if that confidentiality means, you know, this person will end up harming himself, killing himself or herself, or end up harming someone else, killing someone else, then that right has to be violated for the client. So... it's pretty challenging where kind of these ethical dilemmas come to. And I think a lot of the courses that I've had as an undergrad in social work was just talking about ethical dilemmas. Because there's so many situations where ethical dilemmas will happen. And it's recently happened with me in my internship. And it's kind of, you know, we learn how to, you know, overcome that and things of that nature. And I'm pretty sure psychologists will also. Psychologists will have their own share of ethical dilemmas. It's very interesting considering, like, kind of the, you know, the different values that we place such importance on. So social work heavily on, you know, cultural competency, social justice, that word, the right to self-determination, and all that. I think psychology, you know, do no harm, evidence-based practice, well-being of the individual, you know, and professional practice. So, and there are a bunch of other things that psychologists place their emphasis on, which I guess, you know, I wouldn't be all that too knowledgeable about, but I do know the commonalities. If you look at both code of ethics, a lot of things are very similar. You know, confidentiality, very similar. The right to self-worth and dignity, very similar. How fees are supposed to be ethical, pretty similar. There are some differences there, actually. I think psychology, APA, is more considering of bartering with clients than with social worker. Social worker, NASW code of ethics is just like, bartering, no, you don't want to do that. Don't barter with clients. But like APA is kind of like, you can, as long as it's not exploitive, and you know there are certain guidelines to bartering with clients. So that's I found that pretty interesting. But yeah, this is an area in which both fields have share so many things in common. But I just wanted to kind of point out like the differences in emphasis. You know, as the name, as you would figure from the name, social work is really about not just the person but the whole environment. And in some ways, psychology is too. There is social psychology. There is psychology research. And the roles. I think it's important that the roles that each preamble mentions. So psychologists, the roles it mentioned is some of the roles, you know, researcher, educator, diagnostician, therapist, supervisor, consultant, administrator, social interventionist, that's an interesting one, and expert witness. Now, notice in social work, expert witness doesn't exist. So we, you know, social work is not as an established field as psychology. Also, you know, if you're going to get anywhere in psychology, you need a doctorate degree. So most psychologists, if they have a job, they're doctors. Most social workers, if they have a job, they're not doctors. So I think that's why, like, it's a more, I think, in terms of professionality, and prestige, which I'll get to talking about in the next video, you know, psychology has more of that, much more prestige. And notice the roles of social workers that are mentioned in Code of Ethics. So, where is that? Was here. Sorry. Oh, sorry. I was in the wrong section there. So the roles. These activities may be in the form of, so it talked about activities, but didn't necessarily talk about the roles. But these are some of the activities that social workers may engage in. To end discrimination, oppression, poverty, and other forms of social injustice, these activities may be in the form of direct practice, which would be like opening up a private practice therapy setting, therapy opus, community organizing, supervision, consultation, administration, advocacy, social and political action, policy development and implementation, education, and research and evaluation. So what's kind of missing there is expert witness, because we're not, and diagnostician, because social workers do not diagnose. That's psychology thing, and it's a psychiatrist thing. And so it also shows you that psychology is in that respect much more established, and rightfully so. I do not want to be a diagnostician. If I wanted to be, I think I would have chosen the field of psychology, and I'm really hesitant to diagnose anyone anyway. But we do use the diagnostic manual, but I explained that in the previous video. Anyway, this has been a long video on this topic. Next video, I will continue talking about, you know, psychology versus social work. But talking about, well, actually, on the next video, I want to talk about kind of careers one could have in both fields. So.